thank you for coming. If you'd like to come over to the lawn, we welcome you.
Thank you.
The lawn, the beautiful lawn. Hi, everyone. So I guess we're all here because we love Bernie Sanders. I wanted to just take you in because around the end of April, when I found out that Bernie was running, I was in the middle of two school programs and trying to start a business, and I dropped everything. And I've been working on this 18 hours a day for the last 6 weeks because Boston needed a base. Showed up, and then 13 people showed up, and then 30 people showed up, and then we thought, let's have 100 people, and we have all this showing up. So you guys are awesome, and thank you. So I just wanted to invite you to arrive. Just be here right now. Be here with each other. Just feel the ground under your feet. This is what we are protecting, and this is what cares for us. Feel the ground beneath your feet. And feel the breath coming into your body. That life coming into your body. And if you can take 1 second to look around and catch the eye of someone you don't know, just hold the gaze for just a moment. Just to know that you're in this together. And tonight, I'm going to hand this over to Eric. He's going to guide you through all our speakers. We're going to have breakout groups, and we're going to create some actions, and we're going to create a lot of relationships with one another, because what this is about is connecting with one another, to know that we are strong, to know that we are going to get this done. Yeah. We're going to get Bernie elected. And we're going to keep the movement going strong long after. And this is what this is about.
All right. Hello, Boston. Hello, Massachusetts, New England, and the world. Good evening. Okay. If you cannot hear me, give me one of these. This is a really loud PA. I think we're okay. Now, before we get started, I want to thank the Parks Department and the Rose Kennedy Greenway Trust that has a space we're standing in right now. They've been very kind to us, and please, keep off the flowers and clean up your trash when you leave at the end of the evening. Thank you. Meanwhile, I want to thank all the groups who have come together to make this possible. Tonight we're going to hear from members of a whole bunch of those. We're going to have speakers who have worked with organizations like Black Lives Matter. We're gonna have a union shop steward, gonna introduce them to you one by one. And after about 45 minutes of speakers, we're gonna move into our breakout groups. We're all gonna get to know each other a little bit better. Now, before anything else, okay. I want to announce our first speaker of the evening. This is Genevieve Morse. Yeah. Genevieve Morse comes from the Massachusetts Teachers Association and from Dorchester. Yeah. All right, she's a shop steward and a union activist. Let's all welcome her to the stage.
Thank you for welcoming me to this rock. So excited to be here, and I'm a member of a proud union member. Yeah. Of the Massachusetts Teachers Association, the biggest union actually in the state and the biggest union in this country. Yeah. And a proud member of Socialist Alternative as well. Yeah. So, I think for all of us here tonight, we're here just like the thousands that have been inspired by Bernie Sanders and what he's been bold enough to talk about and what other politicians would never say. It's clear to me that the amount of people that would show up to an event like this is a real indication of a number of things, and that people have had enough of business as usual politics, and that everyone here is sick and tired of being sick and tired. And that the politics of do nothing for both parties is becoming unacceptable. Bernie says we need a political revolution and a fight against the billionaire class. And what does that mean? Exactly. To me, it means that the political situation in the U.S. is not broken. Nope. It's been shattered into a million pieces by the billionaire class, by the bankers, and by all these bailouts and the politicians that sit in their back pockets. It's corrupt to its core, and it seeks to continue to bring us all down to poverty, wages, to be kicked out of our home and settle for less. This is all going on while the wealthiest continue more than ever to make more money, have more resources, and influences over our lives and our politicians. And because of that fact, and it's a fact that we all know, it means we have to do something about it, that we have an obligation. Everybody here has that obligation to do something. And this is the beginning of building a movement. We're actually on the cusp of a new beginning, a new chapter in U.S. society. That we're in the beginning of building a powerful movement capable of taking on the biggest struggles of humanity, whether it's the environment and climate change, to fighting back against standardized testing and corporate takeover of our schools. Against income inequality, uniting for single payer, ending student debt, and standing together against racism, sexism, and homophobia. And also, Bernie says that the political system is tied with capitalism, as he himself self-identifies as a socialist. And I would agree with that too. We have been living through crisis after crisis with dead-end solutions. Because the truth is, capitalism is crisis. It's a system that thrives off the misery of the millions while the 1% continue to get away with everything for themselves. I think we should ask the workers in Greece how they think this system is working. Losing pensions that they've worked their whole lives for. And I just want to be clear that this IMF, this most recent round of austerity, was not about getting the debt that they shouldn't be getting anyways, but it was actually to collect the interest on the debt. They want us to suffer and then like it. They wanted the Greek people to suffer and like it, and they said no. But the truth is also that this is a global crisis, but that also this is true for the U.S. as well. We're told time and time again there's no money available for things like schools, fixing failing infrastructure, and public transit like we know we could use in Boston. Yet trillions of dollars are given to Wall Street, big banks, during the economic crisis, bailing out these billionaires and giving them golden parachutes when they fail in their corporations and blame it on working people. But I want to talk really briefly, and I'm going to try to move a little bit faster here. I want to talk about the recent endorsement of the American Federation of Teachers' endorsement of Hillary Clinton. Ooh, absolutely, folks. This is one of the first, and I wouldn't say the last, nominations of big unions from the national union. Which is, you know, it's no real surprise to me, especially over the past 30 years, that unions have been in the fight for their very existence. And even with that, we keep throwing our money, our resources, our power, time and time again into people like Hillary, into candidates that actively oppose the rights of working class people. I mean, Hillary sat on the board of Walmart in the early 90s. This is not a candidate that we can and should support as union members.
thousands of dollars speaking in front of the likes of Goldman Sachs. This is also not the conduct of a candidate that we want to see. Today, to win in politics, it just takes one thing, a whole bunch of money. Until unions are willing to make a clean break from both of these parties, this problem will happen time and time again. Instead, we can throw our whole weight into independent politics, like Shama Sawant that ran it as an open socialist in Seattle and won a $15 an hour minimum wage in that city to become the first city in the United States to win that victory. And it has spread to LA and to other cities across the US, and Massachusetts could be next. And that's what an independent candidate looks like. And beyond that, there were labor activists in Lorain County that ran as independent candidates because as one AFL-CIO president mentioned, that they had to take this step reluctantly. They had to run. They ran a slate of 12 people and 10 of them won. And they said, and this is the labor leader, he said, when the leaders of the Democratic Party just took us for granted and tried to roll over our rights, working people said we had to stand up. They decided that they had to take their lives into their own hands. And we see this again with the passing of the TPP agreement. Labor union. Yeah, I know. Amen. With the passing of the TPP, and where millions, and I mean millions of Americans and labor unions actively opposed this, both parties have brokered a deal and agreed to this. It's a disgrace. It's NAFTA on steroids, and it's dangerous for U.S. working people. But I don't say this that I'm not hopeful for the future, and I'm going to wrap up because I have a lot of hope. All of you are bringing me hope. Because I think the key question is, how are we going to achieve the demands that Bernie is placed on us? The Sanders campaign must orient towards strengthening and helping the movements that have developed over the years. Bernie says, and this is a direct quote, a campaign has got to be much more than getting votes and getting elected. It has got to be about helping to educate people and organize people. If we can do that, we can change the dynamic of politics for years to come. He went on to say that we can collect the best person in the world for president, but that person will get swallowed up unless there is an unprecedented level of activism at the grassroots level. And that's exactly who we are, and that's exactly what we'll do. Strengthening these struggles for economic justice and social justice are the most important thing to do. Occupy, Black Lives Matter, the fight for a minimum wage are all indications that change is coming. No one is looking for change sometime down the road or when they're going to say that we can get it. The change is coming now, and the best time for change is in the present. We need to get what we're owed, what we need. Because when we fight, we win. When we fight,
we win!
When we fight,
we win!
All right, next up, I'm very happy to welcome Mary. Mary is a high school student in Cambridge, and she is an organizer with Cambridge Black Lives Matter. Here you go, Mary.
So we're going to do a little chant because I'm a protester and that's what I do. So follow after me. It is our duty to fight for our freedom. It is our duty to win. We must love and protect each other. We have nothing to lose but our chains. It is our duty to fight for our freedom. It is our duty to win. We must love and support each other. We have nothing to lose but our chains. It is our duty to fight for our freedom. It is our duty to win. We must love and support each other.
each other. We have nothing to lose but our chains. So my name is Mary, and I'm a 16-year-old activist from Cambridge. I'm also a proud young black queer woman, so if I, start playing the race card or have a gay agenda and put it in a little kid's meal, that's a joke. So in all seriousness, I'm here to be real and bring the real concerns that young people, queer people, and black people face in this very racist, very heterosexist, very adultist society.
And that first being education. We live in a country that prepares young students of color and low-income students to be in prison, not to go to college, not to go into the workforce, but to go into prison. We spend more money on inmates than we could taking them and putting them into college. College is too expensive. People can't afford college. I can't afford college. How am I supposed to go ahead and succeed and get a job when I can't afford it because our government doesn't think that we should be able to succeed? How are we supposed to get good paying jobs if we can't go to college? How are we supposed to go to college when our students are in prison? In addition to that, we have to get jobs as young people. Young people need jobs. It's enough to put a kid through college, but what happens if that kid doesn't get a job? What happens if they can't pay their loans? What do we do then? We are setting up our people to fail. How are we going to be the number one country in America when our people aren't educated, when our people can't work, when our people aren't living, when they aren't getting a living wage? I'm all about that $15 hours. Woo! Because we need that. How are you going to be able to live in a city like Boston if you can't provide for your family, if you can't go to school, if you can't survive? And Bernie Sanders really does stand with that message, and that's why I'm here, that's why I'm supporting Bernie Sanders, because he's all about that. And it's important that we stick to that, and we believe in that $15 hour minimum wage, that we believe in education, we fight for our young people. As a black woman, it's important that we also say that black lives matter. We live in a country where black lives are being gunned down every 28 hours, where black people can't really get jobs because job discrimination is a real thing, where black trans women are being killed so terribly, and we're not even talking about that. We need to say black lives matter because black lives are being pushed and being marginalized and aren't really cared about in our society. Now, as a queer woman, we also need to go beyond gay marriage and look at the other things facing the queer community. We need to be inclusive with our trans people. We need to recognize that gay marriage doesn't solve everything, that we still have 40% of youth as LGBTQ. How are we letting this happen? We need to ensure that there's housing for our people. And then also, just as a young person, we need to legalize marijuana. We need to stop sending our young people and other people to jail for, you know, enjoying their lives, pursuit of happiness.
No jail.
No jail. Yeah, no jail. Let's get rid of jails. I feel that. So that's all I have to really say. So I'm going to close it out in a chant because, like I said, I'm a protester. And I'm here representing myself. And so there ain't... I have more to say. My bad.
I won't be able to vote in 2016, but what I do hope for is that Bernie Sanders hears us young people and our voices and connects with us, because only 21.5% of people turned out to vote as young people. And the way that I see it, it's because our politicians don't really give a fuck about our lives and what we need. Although some of us can't vote because we're not registered, our voices matter and we have power. So all of the young people out there, please register to vote. Please fight for your voice, because we matter and we're real. So with me, there ain't no power like the power of the youth, because the power of the youth don't stop. Ain't no power like the power of the youth, because the power of the youth don't stop. Ain't no power like the power of the youth, because the power of the youth don't stop.
Say what?
Yeah! All right. We have a huge student presence. If you're a student here tonight,
call out. Students for Bernie, we have one of you coming up now. This is John Mersha. He's a physics major up at Tufts. John, come on up. Yeah. And if you haven't signed up with Students for Bernie, there are a ton of clipboards circulating. Get that information down. We'll get you networked in. Take it away, John.
Thank you, Eric.
Hello.
Okay. Yeah, my name is...
Lord, there's a lot of you guys.
My name is John C. Merfeld. I'm a rising junior at Tufts. I study physics and computer science. That's right, it's distracting.
If you hold it down on the camera,
don't yeah. Oh, yes, thank you. Okay, so I was asked to speak at this event on a topic that really was as specific as I could possibly be given, which is student issues. A student, right? I have issues. I agreed to do this because, much like nearly everyone here, I assume, the message that Bernie Sanders has been articulating so refreshingly over the past several weeks has resonated with me deeply. And I am tangibly relieved that I have the good fortune of an audience that probably already agrees with everything I'm about to say. Because I will admit, I've never in my life been politically active, except for a few votes for blue politicians in the blue states where I've lived. And I think the challenge for me at a moment like this, in a campaign like this, is trying to answer the question, you know, why should I care? And I mean that in all seriousness, because I it's a problem I find not only in myself, but at this persistent idea that I think really is ingrained in the minds of a lot of people our age who assume that things will work out. Just, you know, given enough time. And lately, I have found my belief in that idea waning, and so that's why I want to speak here just briefly today. So to me, this campaign is about clarifying who our government is for and who our policies are meant to serve. To an outside observer, in 2015, it's pretty clear who our elected leaders prioritize. The budget proposed by this Congress called for a $10 billion reduction to the Pell Grant program.
Boo! Shameful!
Pell Grants assist over half of Latino college students and over two-thirds of African-American college students. But we don't have the money for it. We don't, you know, we have to cut that $10 billion from the deficit somehow, and it certainly can't come out of the $25 billion we lose every year to, you know, subsidies to the fossil fuel industry. That would make no sense at all. Those tax breaks. That wouldn't do. It is obvious who our government serves in 2015, and it's not students. Our needs, and the needs of those who will come after us, are being ignored by almost everyone in this government and in this presidential race. Yesterday, we witnessed the launch of Scott Walker's campaign. Walker is the governor of my home state, of Wisconsin, and he has made something of a sport of cutting education funding. I did not hear him or anyone else on the right talking about the $1.2 trillion in student debt, about the cost of college rising at well over 3% a year, about the fact that we in the United States pay an average of 7 times more than anyone else in the industrial world for a college education. I don't hear anyone talking about that. I do hear a proposal from an independent senator from Vermont that would give the federal government foot the bill for most of all public higher education in this country. That's a bill of around $50 billion. That's true. But not only would that money be raised from a tax on Wall Street speculation, which I think we're going to use a good thing, but $50 billion happens to be just under a sixth of what the coal and oil and gas companies make in annual profits. And I don't run out on math, people, but one-sixth is among the smaller fractions. It's a very steep end. So, we stand here at a critical time. With a unique opportunity. We witness a government taking money from things we need and spending it on things we don't want. We've begun to speak up. There's a severe opposition to this campaign. We do not have their money, or their connections, or their offices on Capitol Hill. But what we do have is truly ours. Our time, our voices, and our votes. Everything we have in this campaign, if we can feel in ourselves some of the passion that Bernie Sanders has shown for us, then we will send more than a message to the establishment in Washington. We will send them a president. Thank you very much.
All right. I got love with you. We're a little worried about losing the light, so we're going to jump to our fourth and final speaker. But before we do that, I want to remind everyone here, if you haven't signed up to volunteer or get news, please, please, please find someone with a clipboard and get on our list. They're all over the place. Pull up the clipboards. Okay, they're mostly over there. Anyway, so finally, we have our friend Gabe Barbosa. He is a socialist organizer. He's from Brazil. Gabe, where are you? Right here. All right, come on up.
How are you guys doing tonight? Like Eric said here, I'm from Rio de Janeiro, Brazil. I am a student here in the U.S. And I come here today to speak for you humbly, and please allow me to address you as my brothers and sisters, because from Brazil, but it's America too. South America, but it's one great continent. So I was just sitting back here and listening to all these great speakers who spoke before me. And seeing you all of right now, I wrote a speech here, but I have to say one thing. Learning the 19th century, Alexis de Tocqueville, a Frenchman, came here to America and he wrote a book called Democracy in America because he was so impressed of the power of the American people to organize, to come together, to discuss, to bring the issues. And this is what I see tonight. And Tocqueville could not have gone any more right. And this is what I see tonight. So it is very impressive to see the power that each one of you holds. Thank you. It's the one issue, the one thing that made me come to this campaign, come to Bernie Sanders, is when he spoke openly he was a socialist. I'm a member of the Socialist Democratic Party in Brazil a long time. I grew up in politics. And to see a man, a politician, speak openly about socialism today in America, it's very refreshing. Yeah. We are Americans here. We are all natives to the same soil, to this great continent that splits two oceans apart. I'm from Brazil. It's true that we don't all speak the same language or we have the same skin color, but we are endowed by the same basic rights.
What does socialism mean, right? If socialism means that we will not rest, we as people, we as human beings, we will not rest until a homeless person stays in the streets and is not given a fair opportunity, then I say I'm a socialist. If socialism means free healthcare, an affordable home, and if you can't afford a home, the government will provide you with one. If socialism means to have proper transportation and respectable security for everybody, then yes, I am a socialist. Guys, if socialism means that we use this land, our land, to provide for our people, but also to preserve it for future generations can also enjoy it, then yes, I am a socialist.
I want to
quote Saint Francis, who said, "Be praised, my Lord, through our sister Mother Earth, who feeds us and rules us, and produces various fruits and colored flowers and herbs." My friends, most important of all, if socialism means that my vote, that your vote, that our vote means more than $3 billion donations in campaign finance, then yes, I am a socialist. My brothers and sisters of America, this is a time for us all across America to unite, 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 because we are not a product of capitalism or interest. We are a product of our labor and our heads and our minds and our hearts. Lastly, I just want to thank you again for having me here, and the people who put this together, Julie, Eric, Edmund, Scott, and everybody from Boston for Bernie. Thank you very much.
Okay, time is pressing. Soon we're going to move on to our breakout groups. But first, I want to let everyone know that on the 29th, there is a national event for organizers and volunteers. So watch the main Bernie Sanders site and bostonforbernie.com for details. It'll happen on...
It's already on Facebook.
And it's already on Facebook too, so look there. But it's gonna happen on the 29th. Now, next up, we're going to an exercise. We're gonna have breakout groups where you're all going to meet up and talk about the issues that matter to you and to all of us. There are going to be a bunch of them, so listen carefully. I'm going to announce each one, and the organizer, I want you to jump up and wave your arms around. You got to find your organizer.
We have another speaker, don't we?
What? No, we had to cut the speaker. I'm really sorry. So, we're going to spend about 20 minutes in those groups having our discussions. And then at the end of 20 minutes, we need every group to give us one person to come and give us a 1 minute talk back. Tell us what you talked about. So I'm gonna start listing off the groups. Okay, right over here, we're gonna have a call back on interfaith with Desmond, okay? We've got one on rebuilding infrastructure with Gabriel. Gabriel, where are you? All right, Gabriel. We have a group on reversing climate change with Tom. Reversing climate change, way in the back. Creating worker co-ops. Stacy, right here. Mickey, sorry. Creating worker co-ops, now with Mickey. Growing trade unions. John, growing trade unions. Over there.
Big red shirt over here.
Big red shirt on the side. Raising the minimum wage with Ryan. Yo, Ryan's right here, black and red Muhammad Ali shirt. Okay, pay equity for women workers with Genevieve, who you saw speak, right here, follow her. Trade policies that benefit American workers with Martin. Trade policies that benefit American workers, over there, Marty, new shirt. He's waving. Making college affordable for all with Amy. Over here, Tufts for Bernie, that's Amy. Taking on Wall Street, that's Gabe. Gabe, you're over there. Then we have healthcare as a right for all with Vanessa. Over there, Vanessa, fantastic. Then Edmund from Socialist Alternative, real tax reform. The man in the vest, real tax reform.
I'm grabbing that table. We have chairs.
We have chairs. That's a coup right there. Okay, open discussion with Jason Lowenthal. Jason, where are you at? Right there, Jason, very good man. He was gonna be our fifth speaker, but he bowed out. Then Black Lives Matter with Mary. Mary, where you gone? Mary.
Yeah, Mary.
Right in the front. Jack on immigration. Immigration?
Here.
Right there, hey. Sorry, Jack, there you are. And Diane, get out the votes. Up there, okay, student leader jumping up and down. And finally, oh, that's it, okay. Okay, we have one more, fundraising with James. Over there. Okay, you got 20 minutes.
Yeah,
20 minutes. Come back with a 1 minute callback, okay?
Yeah, sure.
Yes.